Hello and welcome back to the third part, our next chapter in Mastering Identity Management. My name is Walid Meh. I'm a Microsoft Technical Trainer specializing in Azure Infrastructure, Security and Compliance, Security Operations, AI, and Copilot courses. I'm here to walk through the Microsoft SC-300 Identity and Access Administrator Associate course with you. In this video, we are taking the next step to cover implementing and managing external identities. In the session, you'll discover how organizations can securely collaborate with partners, vendors, and contractors by inviting them as guest users, giving them access to resources with precisely controlled permissions. You'll also learn how administrators can fine-tune external user settings to manage how these users interact with organizational data, ensuring compliance and security at every turn. We'll also explore integrating identity providers to support efficient and secure access for all external collaborators. By the end, you'll be ready to enable seamless, secure collaboration no matter where your partners are. So let's get started with implementing external identities in our environment. Now, before we do that, it's important that we understand the relationship between different types of users that you'll have in your tenant. Now, for this, let's have a quick look at the table that we have in our slide deck to understand how that works. First of all, if you look at your members, or you can also refer them to as internal members, this is where most of your organizational employees belong to. So all the people that are employed as part of your organization, we refer to them as members, or you can call them internal members as well. Now, if you're looking to collaborate with users that are outside of your organization and you want to bring them in as contractors or partners or vendors that you want to work with and collaborate with on different solutions, then in that case, you're going to be inviting these users into your environment to work. Now, these are typically what we refer as your guest users or external guest users. In most cases, they will be anyone from outside of your organization. However, we also have another solution or another option to look at, which refers to the external members. Now, typically, this is where you start looking at a solution where you might want to configure a cross-tenant collaboration with another organization. As a part of doing that, you are not required to create or invite those users into your environment. They can live in their home realm where they exist, and they're able to connect into your services or resources and collaborate with you. And this is where we will refer to them as external members or external users. Now, there is a fourth option that's on the slide that refers to the internal guest. Now, this is something that we in the past would have used. Again, we refer to this as a legacy guest user. So not something that we are looking to control or work with going forward. So something that we should be aware of, but again, not something that we will be implementing in our environment. Now, first of all, let's jump through to the portal and see how we start off with inviting an external user to come and collaborate with us in our environments. Right, I'm back onto the portal and I am simply going to start with my users one more time. And in this part, I am starting to click with a new user. Now, instead of creating a new user this time, we are going to click on inviting external user in our environment. And this is how you start the journey. Now, bear in mind, there are only a couple of things that I need to complete in this part of the session to be able to invite an external to my setup or an external user. In this case, the two mandatory fields that I have are the email address that I need to type in for that user, and again, ensuring that it also has a invite redirect URL completed as part of the setup available for me to look at. Now, simply typing in their existing email address, whatever email address that they have, either a personal one, maybe they belong to an organization. If this is an organizational email, you can type that in. And then apart from that, you can complete the rest of the details that are on this form. Things like their display name, on how their name will be displayed in your environment. Do you want to send them an invite message? That could be quite nice if you're sending an email to someone to add them to your environment. A nice message goes a long way. So you can simply come in here and type in a lovely message, welcoming them to part of the project or the team that you're inviting them to collaborate with. And typically this is where, when they receive an email, they'll see a lovely message going from you to them. Now, right at the bottom of that screen somewhere, they'll have a button where they need to click on to accept that invite. And this is where that invite redirect URL takes them. Now, one might be thinking of a question in terms of security at this point. What if this email is taken by someone, or again, forwarded to someone else, someone's taken that link and shared it with somebody else? Does that mean they also can register themselves directly into my environment as an external or guest user? The answer to that is no, simply because this link will verify the email address that you've provided over here in the very first point to invite this user in. And if they can't verify the email address or access to that email address, this link wouldn't work. So it's a secure way of inviting somebody in, and only the user that has access to their email account will be able to redeem this particular URL or complete this the page from the redirect URL. Now, once you've defined all of these details, just like creating a normal user in your environment or a member user in your environment, you get to go into creating their properties or completing their properties page. Again, an advice would be to complete as many of these as you possibly can. These can be then later on used in many different features like your dynamic groups, conditional access policies, and many other places where you can use some of these to group these people or manage or control their access to different resources because they are coming from outside of your organization. So you'll be advised to complete as many of these. Again, one important feature, none of these fields are mandatory. However, an important feature would be here looking at the user's location. Now, if this user is going to come into your environment and needs to have some sort of a license assigned to them for them to be able to complete their task or work with whatever resources they need, in that case, you must have a user's location assigned to them. Otherwise, they won't be able to, you won't be able to assign a license to them as well. So again, some details there to configure. Apart from that, the rest of the details on group membership type, if you want to add them to your group, or if you want to assign them a role for them to be able to perform different tasks in an environment, can be done at this stage, can be done at a later stage. It all depends on how you want to do this. Once you're done with all of these details, typically you'll come into final review and invite, and you will simply hit an invite button, and this will send an email out to them for the invitation that is here. Now, this is as straightforward as inviting a user into your organization to collaborate with you. Now, typically, this user will also be visible for you under the user's menu right over here, and they appear up as a guest. So you see them under the same directory tree, and they're managed right here in your environment. Just as an example, if you look at the bottom of my screen right now, I have a guest user right there simply because I've invited them from using an email address that they use, and I have them available in my environment. Now, apart from inviting a user into my environment, what else can I do? Can I look at managing users that are beyond my directory and still allow them to work with me? Now, for that part of the session, we'll have to jump into looking at external identities to manage details for people. Apart from invitation, how else can I bring them in? Now, one of the options I have over here is to look at cross-tenant settings. Now, this is where by default, my B2B setup is already available. I can invite people in using their email addresses. However, if I am required now to work with another tenant and allow users to work from that tenant to my tenant, now this could be for many different reasons. Maybe they are my partner company that is a vendor that we work with constantly, or they log into some of my resources. Some of my people need to log into their resources. maybe they log into my data source and check my next delivery order that I keep in my setup or my storage account, or I need to go into their setup and check their quantity of resources that are available that we can order. So it could be many different scenarios. And if I want that to happen, I could do this instead of inviting multiple people to my environment and them inviting multiple people from my organization to their environments. We could simply come in here and set up a B2B direct organizational setup, which allows me to ensure that users from my organizations can simply sign into resources from a partner tenant by using their own home realm details. They don't need details for the partner tenant. And based on these settings, given that the inbound, outbound rules that you've defined for both of them are configured well, you should be able to do that without any hassle. So you typically look at your settings in here to define your cross-tenant collaboration. Now, along with that, you might also need to invite other identity providers in your configure other identity providers in your environment. And if you're requesting users to authenticate using some of these identity providers, you can do that from in here as well. All you're doing is back into the external identities and looking at all identity providers. And in here, we can go back and configure different identity providers. And this is where my users simply go into authenticating themselves to an identity provider and are able to log into some of the resources that they want to access in my environment. Now, for me to be able to configure this, all I need to do is come in here and define any one of these details. For instance, if they belong to another intra-tenant, I can configure that, some of the settings that I've already configured. Now, apart from that, we have other options. If they're using just a Microsoft account, if they're using Google, Facebook account, all you need to do is hit configure to one of these settings and provide the details that you would have for you to be able to configure that setup. So when the user tries to sign in, they are redirected to their identity provider, which then authenticates them and brings them back in here once they're authenticated for them to be able to access my resources. Now, if you don't see a service visible to you that you think you use most commonly, how you can still go and configure some custom details in here by simply adding any modern authentication or identity provider that works with some modern authentication protocols like of your SAML or WS Federation. And based on that, you can bring them in here as well to be validated and be able to work within your organization as well. Now, apart from that, if I look at the settings that I have for my external collaboration, these are tenant-wide settings again that we are looking at. In this case, any changes that I make to these settings apply to all my guest and external users that I have in my environments. So it's important to know that any changes you make here will impact everyone that's not a member in your organization. If you are looking to do this for a certain set of users, then maybe look for other ways of doing this. Things like conditional access policies will help you with that. Now, very briefly, if I click or if I talk about some of these, for instance, we want to look at guest user access to some of my resources. You can see there are always options for you to be most inclusive or most restrictive. And then you have another option that you can choose in between both of those here. Again, kind of access they'll get to look at my user properties. Can they or should they or should they not see any of that information apart from their own settings? Now, guest invitation settings. Who can invite guests into my environment? And this is, again, based on your security needs. You might need to change that. You might have most inclusive. Anyone can invite anyone in my organization. Or you can go into most restrictive, saying no one in my environment can invite anyone apart from or including the admins. So most restrictive. Or we have some options in between where we can say, hey, we can allow specific users to invite different people in my environment, or member users and user assigned to a specific admin role should be able to do that. So we pick and choose on a resource or the settings that fit our need in here, and we can configure that. Now, apart from that, we have some other options over here to see that can an external user leave my tenants? Are we making them or giving them this permission to simply go and say, hey, I want to remove myself from your setting? Now, again, if you want to do that, you might want to say yes to it. If not, then you should be able to do no to that from in here. Now, apart from that, we spoke about cross-tenant access settings earlier on. This is, again, talking about if you're looking to do cross-tenant settings and if you want them to be inviting into your environment, should you be able to do that? Again, you have some settings over here to toggle between to see if you'd like to see that happening in your organization, or should you want to block that? And you have some of the settings right here to configure around introducing or bringing in collaborative restrictions to your cross-tenant settings. Right, now, apart from some of these settings that you have that are available for you in Entra to see for your external or B2B configuration, there are some other settings that we can look at. Now, for this, I am going to jump onto my admin center for my M365, which is on admin.microsoft.com. And when I am in admin.microsoft.com, going into looking at loads of different admin portals that we have available under all admin centers that I am currently looking at, in here, if I, for instance, pick up one of the solutions that I might be working on, let's assume we go into Teams and I'm looking to manage some settings for my Teams. Now, this takes me into my Teams portal where I can look at managing configuration for a particular resource. In this case, Teams admin portal that I'm going to manage. When I'm in here in Teams admin portal, there might be additional settings that I might be able to configure for users that are members and users that are external. Now, for a very quick overview of this, if I go into the blade for it under the users, I can see manage users, guest access. So I can see some of those details right here. And again, you can see there are certain settings that I can define to be different across my entire tenant for users that are guests. And in this case, do I want them to be able to do certain things? For instance, delete messages, or I don't know, delete chat, or some of the other options that we have in here. And we can do the same for external access in here, create some policies for them if we wanted to. And we have options for B2B members that you can define some options for them as well. So it's worthwhile looking at your entire Entra-wide settings for external users, along with also looking at different resources that you have in your environment, like Teams and many others, that you can go into configuring access for external users into your environment. This concludes our session. We encourage you to review the reference modules, check your knowledge with the additional study materials, watch other videos in this course, or search out your next favorite topic on Microsoft Learn at aka.ms/learn. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.